What's up, ladies? How are you guys? It's Janice Batista here, and I am so excited on this Power Praying Friday to be here with you guys to share the word. Let's start praying this morning. Amen. Heavenly Father, I come before your presence, Father God, in the mighty name of Jesus. God bless you, Susie. God bless you. We pray, Father God, that this broadcasting today, Father God, may be an amazing one, Father God. You have given me a word, Father God, to share with the ladies this morning. God bless you, Chantel. God bless you guys. And I pray, Father God, that this word will not fall on rocky ground. Father God, I pray that this word will fall on good soil. We bind every demonic force, Father God, that wants to come up against this word. Every demonic force, Father God, that wants to bring confusion. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we rebuke it and we send it back to the dry places where they belong. Father God, and in the mighty name of Jesus, we declare that this broadcasting is going to be a blessing to our spirit, a blessing to our souls. We know that you're going to do a mighty work. How many can believe that God is going to do a mighty work this morning? Amen. We declare the blessings of the Lord over each and every one of your lives. And I am just so excited. God bless you, Glenda. I am just so excited to be here with you guys. When I tell you guys that the Lord, the way he is going to unravel this word today, when I tell you, God bless you, sweetie, it is going to be amazing. Amazing is not even the word, the way this word is going to touch you guys. Amen. So let's get started. You guys know that we are going to be studying the series is Skeleton in the Closet, and this is part two, okay, today. So we already know last week we learned that we shouldn't be living a lie. Last week we learned that we shouldn't be living in the past. We also learned that it's important to accept things, embrace our past, embrace our present, so that God will continue to develop us, right? So that we can continue doing his mighty work here on the earth. And we also learn how we need to die spiritually after Christ died physically, so that once we die spiritually, he can now live in us and we can just continue flourishing. So we have to continue decreasing so he can increase, right? So I already told you guys, I'm going to teach you guys how to combat the enemy when he tries to keep you handicapped, and how he tries to keep you under his dominion and his controls. And I'm going to give you guys this tactics that you need to go up against him in the mighty name of Jesus. So I'm going to teach you guys this afternoon how to flip it on him, okay? So whenever he tries to use your past against you, whenever he tries to belittle you, you just continue spitting the word at him, just like Joseph did, okay? So I'm going to read to you guys the story of Joseph. I wanted to break it down and, you know, just say it to you guys, but it wasn't what the Lord wanted this morning. He wants me to literally read the certain sections that we are going to be reading this morning. I hope it may not be too much Bible for you guys. Like I said, I hope that you guys are ready to receive what God is going to deposit into your spirit today. And before we get started reading the verses that the Lord put in my heart, I wanted to talk to you guys really quickly about some dreams that I had, okay, that were very prophetic in my life, okay? So one of the most prophetic dreams that I remember I had, I was in New York City, and I don't know if any of you guys are familiar with Times Square, okay? If you guys are familiar with Times Square, please let me know if you guys know, the area of Times Square. But this is normally where a lot of people during New Year's celebrate the New Year. And what they do is people get together in Times Square from all walks of the earth. When I tell you, people come from London, from China, from all over the place. They just come to New York City to do the countdown, okay? And they do 10, 9, 8, 7. And if you guys can see, the whole Times Square strip is always jam-packed with thousands and thousands and millions of people there to say Happy New Year. So in this one dream that I had, I remember we were celebrating, I guess, the New Year's, and they did the countdown. And when they normally normally do the countdown, I think they throw confetti in the air, okay? So in this one dream that I had, instead of them throwing confetti, it was so weird because from the top, they threw down a balloon. And, you know, it was weird to me because instead of the balloons going like this and going back up because, you know, they obviously they got helium or flying, whatever, this balloon kept flying down from the top. It, like, came from the top sky, right? So it came going down and everybody was going crazy and everybody was pushing and shoving each other to grab this balloon. And as the balloon was coming down, I remember everybody who was around me, like, they were like literally trying to put their arms so high up to reach to it, like to grab it, you know. And I wasn't really making an effort to grab it. Like, I didn't realize why everybody was like going crazy to grab the balloon. Like, I looked at everybody like they were a bunch of crazies, like, why y'all all tripping to grab this balloon? So anywho, because everybody was doing it, I reached my hand out, and the balloon, when people were going like that and they couldn't grab it, the balloon literally fell into my hand because it had a little string off the balloon. So it goes into my hand and I grab it, right? And then all of a sudden, the moment I grab it, it was like I could hear people go like that, and everybody backed away from me, and it was like they made like a little circle. It was like I was alone in the little circle, and everybody just like went back to look like, oh my God, she's the one who got it. And there were millions of people that were there in the dream. So I woke up from the dream, and that was a very, God bless you, Angelica, that was a very prophetic dream in my life, where I think that was like in the beginning of preaching, I guess, in our ministry. And I can't explain to you, like, it's so many things that happened to me after that, okay? There were so many things that I had to deal with, so many things that I had to battle with, but I didn't know I was gonna have a ministry. I didn't know the Lord was gonna take me where he was gonna take me. I didn't know these things, but the Lord knew. And that's why I tell you guys, it's very important to pay attention to prophetic dreams, because they have a lot to do with where God is taking you. Even though at that moment I didn't realize it, and I struggled my first 2 years. Like, even now, I still struggle sometimes when I'm preaching in Spanish, because there are days where I do really good with the Spanish, and there are days when I'm not doing too good with the Spanish, but I'm obedient to the Lord, and I still continue to try. It's not easy to preach in English and in Spanish, but it's the calling that God has over me. There are so many people that they may preach, and you may see them on YouTube, and they preach only in English, but the people that God has called me to are people from all over the place that are tuning in Spanish from different places. So I have to, you know, the calling that's over my life is a bilingual calling. And, you know, and God said, you're going to preach to the nations. And he also said, I was going to sing to the nations. So even in one of these dreams, I remember there was an angel that was calling out to me. It looked like a paradise, okay? And I remember this angel that was, I was watching him from the balcony. And I remember he was calling me out to go to him in the balcony. And when I went to see what he was showing me like everywhere where we were walking, it was like mal de cristal. It was like a sea of glass, okay? And this is biblical when they talk about the new heavens and the new Jerusalem. And I remember walking on the glass, and it was just like, wow, it was just like so amazing. And in that same dream also, I remember being back in the balcony, okay? And I remember there was like this demonic demon that kept trying to grab me. And I remember that in that dream, I kept singing, I kept worshiping the Lord. And as I continued to sing and worship, I remember that the enemy couldn't get me. It's like every time I kept singing to the Lord with I kept elevating physically. Like, I kept physically going higher and higher off the balcony, and the enemy couldn't reach me. And he kept trying to reach me, but he couldn't, because I kept realizing that the more I worshiped, the more I was able to get away from him. So he kept trying to go higher, but the more I sang and the worship, he kept, you know, I kept moving away from him and being in victory, and he wasn't able to snatch me up. So that was one. Another dream I remember really quickly is when I was on the beach, and I was looking out to the ocean, and I remember seeing Jesus walking towards me. Now, I couldn't see his face. I remember seeing like his garment, white garment. I remember it was like he had sandals on, like the same way you would see Jesus like in the movies and stuff like that, when they show you certain images of like him walking on water or something like that. It was kind of like that. And as he was walking towards me, he had a cup in his hand, and it was like a golden cup, okay? And he gave it to me while I was sitting there in the beach, and he gave it to me, and I don't remember if he said some beautiful things to me, and he walked back into the water. And those are very prophetic. God bless you, Stephanie. Those are very prophetic dreams, you know? So those are things that have to do with our calling. So every time I may be stressed out, every time I'm, and that's just one of the many. When I tell you I have a lot of dreams, like God has gifted me a lot in the area of dreams. And that is another reason why sometimes the enemy will try to throw dreams at me too, because there are certain dreams that I have of God and certain dreams that I have that I know are not from God. So we have to be very vigilant. So I would advise you guys to start taking a little notebook, and like I said, start writing down your dreams and start letting the Lord help you discern it, because they have a lot to do with where God is taking you. He will communicate. Amen. Yes. And God is so amazing. When I tell you, like, that's why sometimes whenever I doubt myself and I be like, you know what, God, I can't do this. Or you know what, God, I feel like you didn't call me for this. He always reminds me. Or I might go through my little dream book and I might look and I might remember something. And I got to remember, I'm called for this. I didn't ask to be here. I didn't call myself. You know, this is not something that I wanted to do. But he knew that I was going to be chosen to preach in front of multitudes of people from all walks of the earth. And Times Square is a place where is a public major platform. And God was revealing to me from before what he was going to do with me. So now in this point in time, I don't have space for the enemy to discourage me. I cannot allow him to stop me, because I have to recognize, I'm recognizing where I came from. I'm recognizing where I'm at and how I'm being developed in this moment and in this season, because there is another place, another platform, a higher platform, a higher level of anointing, a higher level of grace, a higher level of wisdom, a higher level of understanding, where God is taking not only me, but all of us to that place. So he uses me and my place where I'm at now, because there was a place where I came from, and I'm able to minister to people that were in that season. That's why everything that I preach to you guys, if it's not something that I went through, if it's not something that I can relate, I don't waste my time, because I need to preach to people from a place that I know, a place that I've been through. So a lot of people, even when I do certain you know, things on my page, people may think, oh, are you angry with somebody? No, I'm not angry with anybody. I'm just speaking from a place where I know to speak from, and I know the Lord tells me to speak on that morning. And I might speak on that, and people may think, you know what, that there's something wrong with me that day, or that I'm angry or I'm upset about something, and I'm really not. It's just a word that God had me deposit for somebody else. Okay, so we have to take those experiences that we go through and put them to good use. That is one of the ways that we combat the enemy, and we use what the enemy used for bad, that's how we use it for good. Okay, that's why, like I said, the series Skeleton in the Closet, we're gonna see how Joseph also combated the enemy, and how God glorified himself in such a mighty and powerful way. Okay, so we're gonna be reading today in Genesis, I think 37. Yes, we're gonna be reading in Genesis 37, and I'm gonna start in 1. So like I said, this is gonna be a lot of Bible, but I have to give it to you guys exactly the way the Lord put it in my heart, okay? So the word of God is read in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And it says, so Jacob lived in the land where his father Isaac... Oh, wait, hold on. I'm reading the... Okay, that was the Amplified. Let me go to the NIV. Sorry, wrong side. Okay, so Jacob lived in the land where his father had stayed in the land of Canaan. This is the account of Jacob's family line. It says, Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending to the flocks with his brothers and sons, Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives, and brought their father a bad report about them. Okay, so now we see Joseph was 17 years old. We see that he was giving his father a report of everything that was going on with his brothers, and it wasn't good. So the brothers was already building a bad reputation. now Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other sons because he had been born to him in his old age and made him an ornament robe for him. Now, that wasn't the only reason why Israel loved his son Joseph. Now, Israel was called Jacob before he was called Israel. That was the name that God gave him. If you guys remember, and if you guys read in the beginning of the Bible, when Jacob was arguing with the angel and he fought for his blessing, that's why God changed his name from Jacob to Israel. But Jacob was also, he had other wives. I don't know if you guys remember the story when he was married to Leah first, but he really loved Rachel, and the father was playing tricks on him and made him work for like 7 years, and then he thought he was gonna get Rachel, and then he tricked him and he married Leah, and then he had to work for 7 more years and things like that. And Leah was always going up against Rachel because there was a lot of jealousy there, a lot of animosity, a lot of bickering between them two. Okay, so this is one of the other reasons why Israel, aka Jacob, right, was in love, loved his son Joseph. Now, because not only did he love Rachel and he had Joseph with her, but he also had Benjamin. Okay, so Benjamin was another brother that he had from Rachel. So Benjamin and Leah, okay? And this stuff is very important to understand the significance of what is to come, the prophecies that God did through the dreams and everything. All of this has to do with it, okay? So he says, not only did he love him because of his old age, and he made him an ornament, a robe for him, right? It says, when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not even speak one kind word to him. So now his brothers, they must have knew, like, wait a minute, my father loves this one because he loved his mom more, and not only that, because he's older, because the father was older, he was wiser, he knew God, he had a relationship with God. So, you know, these sons that he had weren't walking righteously, but then he knew that he was raising Joseph up in a special way. He was obedient. Anything that he said do, Joseph was there, he was willing to do it. So then Joseph, and so that caused animosity between the brothers, okay? And even so as we see in 5, it says Joseph had a dream. When he told it to his brothers, they hated him all even more. He said unto them, listen to this dream that I had. We were binding sheaves of grain out of the field when suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed down to it. His brothers said unto him, do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us? And they hated him all the more because of his dream and what he had said. Okay, so now Joseph, being just 17 years old, knows that his brothers can't stand him, decided to share this dream that they had. Now, you also got to be careful who you share your dreams with. Not everybody in church, you go and you run to them and tell them about your dreams, okay? Because there are certain people that, you know, can work against you also because they know your calling and they know your dreams. Now, will they, you know, benefit in it? No, but also be very vigilant. Don't go telling everybody, oh my God, I had a dream that God was going to give me a ministry of healing. And then they be like, you already, you don't know who you're saying that to. And all of a sudden, they just start working against you and they start trying to demise your ministry before you even get it. Okay, that's why a lot of people, they are stagnant in church because they tell the vision, they tell the dreams to the wrong people. Okay, so because before they can even, you know, turn around and wait for the blessing to happen, the enemy already done did some spiritual work to snatch it up, to bind that person's ministry, to bind that person's vision, to bind that person's capacity. Okay, so that they don't operate in the full capacity that they could, because that's the enemy's job. Okay, so it says his brother said unto him, do you intend to reign over us? Okay, will you? Okay, so they said that because of the dream. Okay, and then 9, then he had another dream and he told it to his brothers again and said, listen, he said, I had another dream, and this time the sun and the moon and the 11 stars were bowing down to me. when he told this to his father as well as his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, what is this dream you had, right? So let me explain to you guys why the father was rebuking him, okay? So he was rebuking him also. Remember, this is the man of God. Remember the dream that he had, the first dream. The brothers were already like looking at him like what he was speaking was foolishness, okay? So the father had more wisdom and he knew that he could trust him, but the influence of the brothers was contaminating the thought of mind of the father, okay? So that's why he rebuked him and said, what is this dream you had? Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down to the ground before you? Okay, so this is so important because now the father speaking foolishly like the brothers did, because the father was not able to discern what was coming from God and what wasn't coming from God. So he allowed the negative brothers and the negative things that they do to become a negative influence in their life. So this is important because we all have things in our life that we are dealing with. We all have people that want to rise up against us and speak negatively about us. We all have people that want to rise up and speak false testimonies against us and our ministry, and they try to come up against us to go up against our ministry and our calling. That's what the enemy does, okay? So that's what the enemy was doing. He was using these people. And I know people physically in my life now that are parents, okay, that are manipulated by their children. There are parents that I know now that do not have a good relationship with their kids because they're going up against each other. So then, and there are parents that live according to the flesh that choose to love the negative people that are living in the negative sons and daughters that are living in the flesh. Oh, these are more, you know, good children, and these are not as good children because these go to church and because these are hypocrites and because these whatever. So they will choose to put in the world, physical world, these knuckleheads that don't worship the Lord. They put them on the top. They put them on a pedestal, okay, because they're all their fleshes are the same. They working iniquity, they working in darkness, and that's why a lot of godly children tend to suffer more, and they tend to suffer a lot of rejection because of the cross, because of their faith in Jesus. When Jesus is good, Jesus is just promoting love and peace and joy. And it's like, even now what's going on in the earth, everybody look at everything that's happening in the earth now, all the school shootings, okay? Everybody in every TV show, everywhere in the news, everybody's talking about gun violence. Stop the gun violence. Stop this. Stop that. Why are these people so full of hate? People want answers. They want to know, why is this happening? And it's happening because you guys have pushed God out of the school system. You don't want to welcome God into the school system. You don't want to teach people principles, godly principles and godly morals. So you allow, because this is a godless generation, they're allowing the bullying to take place. Nobody is doing nothing about it. So it's causing these people who don't have God in their life, there is easier for the enemy to work through them, okay? Does it make it okay? No. Does that mean that God can't stop it? Yes, he can, but this is prophecies. These are all things that need to happen. These are all things that need to take place. That's why he says, if this is a wicked generation, if my people who are called by my name would repent from their wicked ways, will repent from their sins and bow down and worship me and ask me for forgiveness, to forgive them for their iniquities, then I will heal their land. Then I will, you know, bring more crops. Then I will do more amazing things, because people want change. People want prosperity. People want the blessings in the earth, but they don't want to recognize the power it comes from. They don't want to recognize the authority. They don't want to recognize the rules and the laws that are in the Bible that were established for us, okay? So this is very important because this has to do with a lot of what's going on now, okay? So we see that his father rebuked him and said, are me and your mother, are we gonna actually come and bow down to the ground to you before you? So his brothers were jealous of him, and the father kept this matter in mind. So the father, even though he rebuked him and it made the brothers more furious, he kept it in mind because he still knew God and he was still wise. He knew of God. He knew, so he couldn't get the matter out of his mind, okay? So now his brothers had gone to gaze their father's flock near Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, "As you know, your brothers are gazing the flocks near Shechem. Come, I am going to send you to them." "Very well," he replied. So he said unto him, "Go and see if all is well with your brothers and with the flocks, and bring word back to me." You see how he knew he could trust him. Then he sent him off from the valley of Hebron, and Joseph arrived at Shechem. A man found him wandering around in the fields and asked him, "What are you looking for?" He replied, "I am looking for my brothers, and can you tell me where they are gazing their flocks?" "Then they have moved from here," the man answered. "I heard them say, 'Let's go unto Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them near Dothan. Now look at this. Look how conniving these brothers are, okay? He says, but they saw him from a distance. So they saw him coming from a distance, and before he reached them, they plotted to kill him. So this is how evil and wicked they were. And they said, "Here comes that little dreamer," they said to each other. "Come now and let's kill him and throw him into the cistern and say that a ferocious animal devoured him. Then we will see what comes of his dream." So you see, these brothers were wicked. They was like, "Look at this little dreamer. Let's see what's gonna come now of his little dreams," because he thinks he's all that. He thinks that he's special. And sometimes that's how people get with us. They see us with our shine. They see us with our godly glory that God gave us. They see us being blessed. They see us being prosperous. They see us just doing the thing, okay? They see God doing the thing in us, and they get jealous. There are people that they get furious. They get angry. They get upset, okay? So when Reuben heard this, he tried to rescue him from their hands. And he said, "Let's not take his life," he said. Now, Reuben was one of Leah's sons. So you see, he wasn't evil, okay? He was one of them from her lineage, but he wasn't wicked, okay? He said this. So when Reuben heard this, he tried to rescue him from their hands. "Let's not take his life," he said. "Do not shed any blood. Throw him into the cistern here in the wilderness, but do not lay a hand on him," Reuben said, to rescue him from them and take him back to his father. So Reuben's intention was to say, "You know what, let's just throw him here and forget about him and go back," because his intention was to go back when his brothers weren't looking, to go rescue him and bring him back to the dad, just to make him suffer a little bit. So they weren't trying to do it to be, you know, vicious and mean, even though they were, but you know what I mean. So it says, "So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the ornament robe he was wearing, and they took him and threw him into the cistern. Now the cistern was empty and there was no water in it. As they sat down to eat their meal, they looked up and saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead. Their camels were loaded with spices, balm, and myrrh, and they were on their way to take them down to Egypt." Okay, so Judah said to his brothers, "What will we gain if we kill our brother and cover up his blood? Come and let us sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay a hand on him. After all, he is our brother and our own flesh and blood." So all his brothers agreed on this, okay? So they was like, "You know what? We want to get rid of him, but let's not kill him. He does belong to us." So they had a little bit of a conscience, even though the Bible says that they didn't speak to him, even though they said that their hearts kept being full of hate even more. These were all demonic spirits that were hovering over that family, okay? These were all things that had to play out. That's why I tell you, certain times now in your life, if you feel that people are coming up against you, and one moment they love you and one moment they don't, believe me, all of this has to do with God's amazing plan. It says, "So when the Midianite merchants came by, his brothers pulled Joseph up out of the cistern and sold him for 20 shekels of silver. So the Ishmaelites took him to Egypt," okay? That's how Joseph got to Egypt. When Reuben returned to the cistern and saw that Joseph was not there, he tore his clothes. He went back to the brothers and said, "The boy isn't there. Where can I turn now?" Then they got Joseph's robe, slaughtered a goat, and dipped the robe into the blood. They took an ornament robe back to their father and said, "We found this. Examine it to see whether it is your son's robe." So you see how conniving they were to the father. God bless you, Lillian. It says, "He recognized it. It is my son's robe. Some ferocious animal has devoured him. Joseph has surely been torn to pieces." Then Jacob tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and mourned for his son many days. And his son and daughters came to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. He said, "I will continue to mourn until I join my son in the grave." So his father wept for him. Meanwhile, the Midianites sold Joseph in Egypt to Potiphar, one of Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guards. Okay, so now we see how the Lord allowed all of this to take place, right? So the brothers sell him to these Ishmaelites. You know, he sells them, and then they go and sell him to the captain of Pharaoh's officials. So he went to the captain's house. Okay, so he didn't go to some random other little person. He went to the captain of the Pharaoh. Okay, and this is very important, because we see that if you can tell, I'm not going to read everything in there because I have other stuff that the Lord wants me to read to you guys this morning. But if you continue reading the story, when he went to the captain's house, God put a certain favor over Joseph when he went there. The captain started to see that everything that Joseph touched began to flourish over and over again. So God put amazing favor on him. But what happened? He was full of humility. He was very humble, and he was a hard worker. So guess who saw that and wanted a piece of that? The captain's wife. So she looked at Joseph, saw that he was humble, saw that he was hardworking. And if you continue to read on, you see how she wanted to be with him, and even, you know, took her clothes off, wanted to get intimate with him. Now, mind you, this is the captain's wife. She must have been looking good, smelling good, had the best perfumes, the best hairstyles, the best of everything, because they were top in society. So when she says, "You know what, Joseph, I want to be intimate with you," he gets scared and he's like, "No, I'm not gonna do this to my master. He has been good to me. He's providing for all my needs. He's giving me shelter. He's giving me food. I am working here under him, and I will not do this detestable thing to my master." So she must have been so offended and so angry and so bitter, because she must have been thinking in her mind, like, "You know what? How dare you? You know how many men want to be with me? You know how many men want to lie down with me? And you little wicked peasant little thing, I gave you the opportunity to lay with me and you said no to me." So she was so angry and she was so offended that she chose to lie and started to tell the guards and started to yell and say, "He's trying to rape me. He's trying to abuse me." The guards come, her husband comes, the official, the captain, and she's like, "Listen, he tried to rape me." So what does he do? He asks him, "What's going on? Did my wife do this to you? This, that, and the third." And he says, "Listen, you know me. I've been here working for you faithfully. I love you. I'm serving under you. But your wife wanted to be intimate with me, and he ran away from her." So in the name of Jesus, Father God, I come against any demonic spirit. You see, every time I be preaching to you guys deep stuff, I'm telling you, the enemy, I rebuke the enemy in the name of Jesus. I rebuke all those headaches, all those attacks that the enemy tries to send my way. I rebuke him now in the mighty name of Jesus and declare that anything that he tries against me, I am covered by the blood of Jesus. Amen. So there are always spiritual things, because this is real. I'm giving you guys some really, really, really good words today, okay? So what happens is that he gets sent to prison because he didn't have no other choice, because this is his wife making this claim up against him. But he knew that this little boy was honest. He knew that he was God-fearing. He knew that he had favor. Amen. God bless you, Janie. God bless you, sweetie. So now while he's in prison, he meets two people. He meets a cupbearer and a baker, okay, in the prison. So look at how the story unfolds, okay? Amen. Yes, sisters, keep covering me in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. So it says, I'm reading now Genesis 40. It says, so sometime later, the cupbearer and the baker of the king of Egypt offended their master, the king of Egypt. Pharaoh was angry with his two officials, the chief and the cupbearer and the chief baker, and put them into custody into the house of the captain of the guards in the same prison, where Joseph was confined. Okay, so that's how they all met each other. The captain of the guard assigned them to Joseph, and he attended to them. After they have been in custody for some time, each of the two men, the cupbearer and the baker of the king of Egypt, who was being held in the prison, had a dream that same night, and each dream had a meaning of its own. God bless you, Don. So this is like, I'm saying, this is amazing what we're reading right now. It says, when Joseph came to them the next morning, he saw that they were dejected. So he asked Pharaoh's officials who were in custody with him in his master's house, why do you look so badly today? We both had dreams, they answered, but there is no one to interpret them. So Joseph said unto them, do not interpretations belong unto God? Tell me your dream. So the chief cupbearer told Joseph his dream, and he said unto him, in my dream I saw a vine in front of me, and on the vine there were three branches. As soon as it was budded, it blossomed, and it clustered, and its clusters ripped open into grapes. Pharaoh's cup was in my hand, and I took the grapes and I squeezed them into the Pharaoh's cup and put the cup in his hand. This is what the dream means, Joseph said unto him. The three branches are 3 days. Within three, this is important, okay? Within 3 days, Pharaoh will lift up your head and restore you to your position, and you will put Pharaoh's cup in his hand, just as you used to do when you were his cupbearer. But when, and look at what Joseph says to him, because now the vision, you see, Joseph had the skill and the talent and the charisma to interpret. God bless you, sweetie. The Lord, he had this charisma to interpret the dreams. He had the dawn, the talents to interpret it. So once he does that, he says to him these words. He says, but when it all goes well with you, remember me and show me kindness. Mention me to the Pharaoh and get me out of this prison, because I was forcibly carried off from the land of the Hebrews, and even here I have done nothing to deserve being put in this dungeon. Okay, so now, because he prophesies to the cupbearer, he says to him this prophecy, this he interprets it for him, and he says, look, this is gonna happen to you. I believe it. Please, when you get to the Pharaoh, put in a good word for me, because he knew that the Pharaoh was higher ranking, was above the captain who had put him there, you know, because of his wife. So he was already, you know, upset. So look at this. So now when the chief baker saw that Joseph had given a favorable interpretation, he said to Joseph, I too had a dream, right? So now look at how the table, look at what, this is what I'm telling you. I love the Bible. I love the word, because it's just so amazing. He goes, on my head, there were three baskets of bread. In the top baskets were all kind of baked goods for Pharaoh, but the birds were eating them out of the basket of my head. And this is what it means, Joseph said. The three baskets are 3 days. Within 3 days, Pharaoh will lift off your head and impale your body on a pole, and the birds will eat your flesh away. So now he gives this one prophecy to the cupbearer, and he says, wait a minute, your prophecy is gonna be good. So he's like, you're gonna be blessed, you're gonna be out of here, you're gonna get out of this prison, and you're gonna go back to the position with no problem. So then the other one, he says, wait a minute, you're about to die in 3 days. So the other one was thinking, like, okay, I want the blessing too. I want to know, like, what does my dream mean? So when he hears this, right, this is what it means. And he, you know, he says to him that he's gonna die, right? So it says, now on the third day So the third day was Pharaoh's birthday, and he gave a feast for all the officials, and he lifted up the head of the chief cupbearer and the chief baker in the presence of his officials. He restored the chief cupbearer of his position so that he once again can put the cup into the Pharaoh's hand. But he implied the chief baker so that Joseph said to them in his interpretation. The chief bearer, however, did not remember Joseph, and he got up and he forgot him. Okay, so now he remember what Joseph tells him. He's like, listen, Dios le bendiga, Blanca, how are you, sweetie? So you see what happens. Now he forgets, right? He told him, remember me. Okay, so now he goes and he doesn't remember him. He goes, and that's what happens with a lot of people. A lot of people will come to church and they will be like, I need God to bless me. I need God to do this for me. I need God to do that for me. And the minute God does it, the prophets will be like, yo, God is going to do this and this for you. But when he does it, when he gives you that promotion, when he gives you that house and you got to put that big down payment and stuff, don't forget the church of God, don't forget to sow a good seed in the house of God, don't forget that, you know, God is with you, and we all praying for you and we are rooting for you. And the same thing, people be like, yeah, when God does this and this for me, I'm gonna bless the church, I'm gonna bless the house of God, I'm gonna pour back into God. And when they leave, what do? They forget, like a lot of people do, right? So he forgets about him for 2 whole years. Okay, can you imagine what Joseph must have been going through? Could you imagine how he must have been feeling? Like, man, my brothers rejected me, everybody forsake me, you know, these people sold me, I was doing good here for a minute, and then this lady wanted to falsely accuse me and say that I wanted to rape her. Can you imagine what he must have been feeling? Now this guy, he already must have knew, went back to his position. Now he didn't have anybody who he could trust. And imagine his faith, he probably must have lost faith in God, maybe, but I don't know what he was going through. But we can only imagine, okay, and assume based on this. So now I'm reading 41. It says, when 2 full years, and like I said, I didn't want to read all of this, but the Lord was like, you're going to read all of this morning because the sisters need to hear this, okay? So he says, when the 2 full years had passed away, okay, had passed, Pharaoh had a dream. He was standing by the Nile when out of the river came up 7 cows, sleek and fat, and they gazed among the reeds. After them, 7 other cows, ugly and gaunt, came up out of the Nile and stood beside those in the riverbank. And the cows that were ugly and gaunt ate up the 7 sleek fat cows. Then Pharaoh woke up, and he fell asleep again and had a second dream. 7 heads of grain, healthy and good, were growing on the single stalk, and after them 7 other heads of grain sprouted, thin and scorched by the east wind. Then the thin head of the grain swallowed up the 7 healthy full heads. Then Pharaoh woke up and realized that it had been a dream. Okay, so number 8, he says, in the morning his mind was troubled, so he sent for the magicians and the wise men of Egypt. So he wanted to go to the high-ranking witches and warlocks, these magicians that practice things in the occult. Okay, that's why I tell you all this has to do with your calling. All of this has to do with what God has been doing in your life, all those skeletons in the closet, and it has a lot to do with you combating the enemy. It has a lot of there's a lot of wisdom and a lot of revelations, a lot of secrets to the kingdom of God in this message. I'm telling you, do not miss it, because you're gonna end up missing it and then being frustrated that you missed it. Okay, do not miss it. Okay, it says, then the chief cupbearer said to Pharaoh, okay, so he sent the wise men out of Egypt, and Pharaoh told him the dreams, but no one could interpret them. So none of those witches, none of those warlocks, none of those people that were practicing the occult had the power and the authority and the grace to interpret this dream. So the chief cupbearer, okay, said to Pharaoh, today I am reminded of my shortcomings. So you see, today, after 2 years, he remembered the young fella who prophesied on him and gave him the word of the Lord. And he said, Pharaoh was once angry with his servants, and he imprisoned me and the chief baker in the house of the captain of the guard. Pharaoh was angry with his servants and he imprisoned me in the house. Okay. Each of us had a dream that same night, and each dream had a meaning of its own. Now a young Hebrew man that was there with us, a servant of the captain of the guard, we told him our dreams and he interpreted them for us, giving each man the interpretation of the dream, and the things turned out exactly how he interpreted them to us. I was restored to my position, and the other man was impaled. The other man was killed. Okay, so exactly what he said. So look at how after 2 years, he didn't even go visit him. After 2 years, he went to go check on him. After 2 years, he finally remembered, because he saw the opportunity for him to be a help to the Pharaoh. Okay, mind you, he was up there with the Pharaoh, so he saw this opportunity. Oh, let me be like a lot of people like to do. They like to, you know, use the opportunity to so it could benefit them, so it can go well with them. That's why he says, wow, man, after 2 years, now I'm remembering my shortcomings. Why? Because he wanted to be, he saw that the magicians and the high ranking wise wizards of the towns and the city couldn't be of help for him. So now he sees his opportunity to be, you know, wise and humble in his presence or whatever. So look at how things take a turn. Okay, so Pharaoh sent for Joseph, and this is why we cannot doubt when you're feeling like you in a dungeon, when you're feeling like you're not gonna prosper, when you're feeling like, man, God forgot about you, when you're feeling like, man, there is nothing else that God can do for you in your situation, when you are feeling like sickness is going to overtake your body, when you are feeling and like you're gonna die in your sickness, when you are feeling that there is no hope for you, when you are feeling poor and you're gonna be living in poverty for the rest of your life, when you are feeling that nobody cares for you, nobody loves you, when you are feeling your worst, when you are feeling that God completely forgot about you and there is nothing left for you to just sit there and die. This is the God that we serve. This is why God is so amazing. Because in those moments when you least expect it, when you feel a filth, okay, when you have no clothes on your back and you see everybody else wearing the hottest Jordans, when you have nothing, God bless you, sweetie, when you see nothing is going good for you, when you see nothing is going right for you, and everybody's wearing the nicest Jordans, the expensive Yeezys, the Balenciaga sneakers, when you see everybody doing good and you just sitting there wearing some, you know, leftover rags, okay, that you have that were leftover or probably given to you by somebody, some family members or some neighbors that gave you those hand-me-downs, you can never doubt God and his majesty and his power and his grace and his anointing, because he always comes in those right moments. So he says, so Pharaoh sent for Joseph, and he was quickly brought from the dungeon. When he had shaved and changed his clothes, he came before the Pharaoh. So they had to bring him before Pharaoh, and they had to switch his garments. I rebuke the enemy in the name of Jesus. I'm telling you, I keep feeling like this oppression trying to stop this broadcasting and stop my train of thought, and I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. I rebuke every devil, every witch, every warlock that tries to come up against this word in the mighty name of Jesus. It says, so Pharaoh sent for Joseph, and he was quickly brought, okay, and came before him, the Pharaoh. They changed his clothes, right? So 15, Pharaoh said to Joseph, I had a dream and no one can interpret it, but I have heard it is said of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it, right? So look at what this humble man of God says. He says, I cannot do it, Joseph replied to Pharaoh, but God will give Pharaoh the answer that he desires. So look how humble. He could have took that moment and was like, yeah, I got power. Yeah, I got anointing. You see how why we have to be humble in his presence? You see why we cannot be buffed up? Because sometimes those people that buff themselves up, God says to them, you know what? Send them back to the dungeon for 2 more years until he gets it. And sometimes we go through these processes and we go through these things where God wants to prove our humility, even when all odds are against us, okay? So he says, then the Pharaoh said unto Joseph, and ladies, when I'm reading this, please intercede for me because I keep feeling demonic oppression trying to come up against my brain, my mind, and my chain of thought. I'm telling you, it's like really crazy today, the spiritual oppression, okay? So he says, Pharaoh desires, 17. He says, when Pharaoh said unto Joseph, in my dream, I saw standing on the bank of the Nile, when out of the river there came up 7 cows, fat and sleek, and they gazed among the reeds. After them 7 cows came up, scrawny and very ugly and lean. I have never seen such ugly cows in the land of Egypt. The lean and ugly cows ate up the 7 fat cows, and they all came up first. But even after they ate, no one could tell that they had done so, and they all looked just as ugly as before. Then I woke up. In my dream, I saw 7 heads of grain full of good and growing on a single stalk. After them, 7 other heads sprouted, withered, and thin and scouched by the east wind. Then the heads of the grain swallowed up the 7 good heads, and I told this to the magicians, but none of them could explain it. And you know what this reminds me of, ladies? This reminds me of Nebuchadnezzar. Remember when Nebuchadnezzar wanted the magicians to interpret it, and he was like, no, I need you to interpret this dream, and if you can't do it, I'm gonna kill you, because you need to interpret this dream. So I think it was Daniel, right? He said, I need you to give me some time to let me pray to God, the one who is the one that reveals the hidden things and the dreams and things like that. So this is like the same thing happening again in life down, but with Joseph. Okay. So then Joseph, said to the Pharaoh, the dreams of Pharaoh are, and we're about to end really shortly. Okay, ladies. And so it says, then Joseph said to the Pharaoh, I gotta pray. Heavenly Father, I come before your presence. When I sit here and tell you, oh my God, I have never felt so much demonic oppression in a video the way I'm feeling it today. Lord, I rebuke the enemy in the name of Jesus. Father God, we want to learn the word. We want to grow. Father God, we want to continue moving in power and in anointing, Father God. And right now, I bind, Father God, every demonic enchanting against me, against my mind, against my spirit, against my godly wisdom that comes from you, Father God. I shield myself with the blood of Jesus. I shield myself now with the armor of Jesus. I shield my sisters. I shield each and every one of us now with the mighty name of Jesus. And I know that this word is going to be a blessing to the sisters. I know that they are going to grow. I know that this is going to be impacting on their lives and that they are never going to be the same. And that's why the enemy is a liar. Satan, I rebuke you. You lying sack of monkey. You are lying little devil, and I rebuke you. You have no power. You have no authority. So we are going to resist you, and you must go and you must flee in the presence of Jehovah God, in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. So then Joseph said unto Pharaoh, the dreams of Pharaoh are one and the same. God has revealed to Pharaoh that what he is about to do. The 7 good cows are 7 years, and the 7 good heads of grain are 7 years. It is one of the same dream. Hold on a second, ladies. I'm telling you, when I sit here and tell you that I rebuke the enemy in the name of Jesus, man, I am sitting here telling you, like, this is like, this is why it's important to fast. This is why it's important to have a godly lifestyle, because it is the fasting. When we come together is what breaks the yokes, okay? This is what it does, because I'm telling you, the enemy is like, he really is feeling intimidated by this word, okay? So he says, a Pharaoh are one and the same. God has revealed to Pharaoh what he is about to do. The seven good cows are 7 years, and the seven good heads of grain are 7 years. It is one and the same in the dream. The seven lean, ugly cows that came up afterwards are 7 years, and so are the seven worthless heads of grain scorched by the east winds. They are 7 years of famine. So now he's interpreting this to him. Amen. Let me get some water really quickly. Amen. It is just as I have said to the Pharaoh. God has shown Pharaoh what he is about to do. 7 years of great abundance are coming throughout the land of Egypt, but 7 years of famine will follow them. Then all the abundance in Egypt will be forgotten, and all the famine will revenge the land. The abundance of the land will not be remembered because the famine that follows it will be so severe. The reason the dream was given to Pharaoh in two forms is so that the matter has been firmly decided by God and what God will do soon. So then he says to him, and we're about to get to the really, really, really good part, amen. He goes, and now let Pharaoh look for a discerning and wise man and put him in charge of the land of Egypt, okay? He says, let Pharaoh appoint commissioners over the land to take a fifth of the harvest of Egypt during the 7 years of abundance. They should collect all the food of these good years that are coming and store up the grain under the authority of Pharaoh to be kept in the cities for food. This food should be held in reserve for the country to be during those 7 years of famine that will come upon Egypt, so that the country may not be ruined by the famine. You see, so God is giving people in position a heads up, and it's the same thing like what's happening now. God is giving so many people a heads up. He's warning them on what's to come, and so many people reject the word of God. So many people reject the teachings of God because they want wisdom fast. They want, give it to me like Burger King. Have it your way. 1, 2, 3. I want it now. And you cannot produce that, okay? You got to be able to produce what comes from heaven, and what comes from heaven is fresh, okay? So he wanted, God is always here to protect us, but it's up to us if we're going to take heed to his warnings, okay? And he does that even nowadays. So he says, 37, the plan seemed good to Pharaoh and to all of his officials, okay? He says, so Pharaoh asked them, can we find anyone like this man, one whom is of the Spirit of God? So you see how he recognized that Joseph had the Spirit of God on him. He knew that what the word, he was saying, man, where could we find? Because none of the magicians is like this. That's why light and darkness are different. They cannot comprehend each other. That's why you have to continue walking in the light. You got to continue walking in the Spirit, even though people in the world reject you, even though they look at your cheap teachings because you don't know how to speak, because you don't know how to speak eloquently, because you don't know how to do certain things that, you know, that the world knows how to do. They look down on you because you don't have the qualifications. But this is to show you what God will do with somebody that doesn't have the qualifications. This is what God does with people, okay? He takes them from little places and he puts them in high places, okay? So look what he says. He says, then Pharaoh said unto Joseph, since God has made all of these things known unto you, there is no one so discerning and wise as you. He says to him, now can you imagine? Now he must have been saying, imagine if he said this in the presence of the chief official, the captain that was under the Pharaoh. Can you imagine if he was there and all of the people that were there were witnessing this, okay? So he said unto him, Manon, there is no one more discerning and wise as you. He says, you shall be in charge of my palace, and all my people are to submit to your orders. Only with respect to the throne will I be greater than you. So he takes him and he puts him into a position second in command. It's like taking somebody from Rikers Island in the prison over there in the island, Rikers Island, and taking them and putting them in the White House. Like, who in their right mind would do something like that? Nobody. So that's why people look at this like, wait a minute, this is crazy. So he says, I'm gonna put you in charge of my palace, and all my people are to submit to your orders, with only with the respect to the throne. There will only be one greater than you, which is me, he says. Okay, so now the Pharaoh said unto Joseph, I hereby put you in charge of the whole land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh took his signet ring from his hand, from his finger, and put it on the finger, on Joseph's finger. So can you imagine? It's like me taking my 2-carat ring, an expensive ring that my husband got for me, and putting it in the hands of a nobody. Just giving, here, I'm gonna give you my ring, the Pharaoh's ring. Okay, can you imagine? They had the best gold, the best silver, the best of everything. So he gives him the ring, he puts it on his finger, he dresses him up in robes of fine linen and put a gold chain around his neck. That's like somebody taking you to the real Louis Vuitton store, somebody taking you to the real the Gucci store, the real there's some Prada store, like so many expensive. Imagine somebody giving you here a whole wardrobe from Gucci, a whole wardrobe from Balenciaga, here all these Prada shoes, and you're like, oh my god, like, see, I just was in prison, I had on a jumpsuit, okay, I had nothing, and now here I am, you know, with all these riches and all this glory. So can you imagine how God was working, how he must have been feeling? So when he put the ring on his finger, he dressed him in robes of fine linen and put the gold chain around his neck. He had him ride in a chariot, and his second in command, and the people shouted before him, make way. Thus he put him in charge of the whole land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh said unto Joseph, I am Pharaoh, but without your word, no one will lift a hand or foot in all of Egypt. So Pharaoh gave Joseph the name of Zaphnath Paneth, and gave him a seventh daughter or whatever, and he had his wife, and Joseph went throughout the whole land of Egypt. Okay, so this is where we're gonna end it right here. Okay, so you see how do you guys see how God literally took him from the bottom? Okay, do you see how God literally took him from the bottom and put him all the way at the top? This is a lesson for each and every one of you guys this morning, to never question God and what he is allowing you to go through in this season. Okay, we all are, even pastors, even the most anointed evangelists, even the most anointed men and women of God, have to go through imprisonments, have to go through these moments of doubt, have to go through these moments of rejection, but it is only for our good. Trust me that the ministry that God said he is going to put in your hands, trust me this morning when I tell you, he is going to put that thing in your hands. I know, based on the dreams that I told you guys at the beginning of the broadcasting, those prophetic dreams are dreams that the Lord gave me, and I know that he is going to do a mighty work in with me. I know that he is going to use me. I know that he is going to take me to high places, and I know and I recognize that the wicked people that try to come up against me and try to do witchcraft up against me, those people that are, they're wasting their time waking up in the nighttime and lighting candles up against me. They are enchanting things against me and my ministry, and guess what? They are wasting their time, because every night I'm getting a good night's sleep. Every night I am declaring that the next day there is going to be more mercy and more grace and more anointing and more revelation than there was the night before. I am trusting. Amen. God bless you, sweetie. Amen. Thank you for the teaching, God's word. Amen, sister. And I am believing God every single day for my breakthrough, for my ministry, for my calling, because each and every one of you guys are depending on it. Okay. And it's the same thing for you. The same way the ladies that are here that are following loving Jesus, that love these teachings that the Lord allows me to bring, there are so many people that are waiting for you guys. They are waiting for you to submit to the Lord. They are waiting for you to pray and bow down in his presence so that God can elevate you in moments where people that are fighting against you can be ashamed. That's why God says, I am going to take the foolish things of this earth and I am going to confound. I'm gonna confuse those wise people, those people that think they're so wise, that think that they know all the answers in this world. That's why you see in life, everything that's going on politically is all a propaganda. It's not really people with spiritual eyes. Or that's why I love this brother that he be preaching real truth. His name is Marcus. I don't know if you guys have seen his preachings online, but he be preaching that fire and he be breaking down the things, the agenda, political agendas, and all that crazy stuff that be going on. He be breaking it down in a very awesome and amazing way. And I'm just so thankful to the things that I hear, the things that I'm able to preach on. Am I as talented as him, excuse me, to interpret certain things the way he does? Maybe not. But I go, you know, I still allow God to use me the way he wants to use me, the way he says he wants to use me. So that's why it's important for you guys to just, you know, get all, like I told you, get all those skeletons out of your closet. Do not allow your past to hinder you. Do not allow your present moment to hinder you. And when you're going to use it for your glory. And if you continue reading down, I cannot read everything because we don't have the time, but if you want to continue seeing how the Lord continued, and remember his brothers, they rejected him, look at how the Lord put him there. That was the moment where prophecy was had to take place. That was the moment where the brothers were going to find out. Guess where your little brother is at, the one that you sold to the slaves. Guess what God did with him. And you're going to see how God unfolded all of that, and how the brothers wept in his presence, and how the father wept. And it's just such a beautiful story. I'm telling you, it's one thing for me to tell you, but it's another thing for you to actually see it for yourself, and for you guys to actually witness it, and for you guys to actually receive from the Lord the way I'm receiving for the Lord. Because everything we go through is for his good, and I'm believing it. So no matter how many people work against me, like I said, they're wasting their time. They may want to see me in the pit, but guess what? They're gonna have to see me in the palace, whether they want to or whether they don't. It don't matter if it takes 2 years, it don't matter if it takes 20 years, it don't matter if it takes 10 years, 5 years, but I will make it. If you're gonna make it into that palace, declare that in the comments below. Say, I am going into the palace. Let's all declare it and say, into the palace we go. How many of you guys could believe that in the mighty name of Jesus? I'm going to be proclaiming that even all this week, all this year. Into the palace I go. Into the the Lord is taking all my rags, all my filthy stuff, and into the palace we all go. We are all going into the palace together. Amen. While I was questioning God and what I was going through, this hard, difficult trial, I was crying in tears, trying to understand. Let me see the rest of it. Trying to understand why me. Amazing teaching. Amen. And now we see, because you have to go through the pit. We all have to go through the pit together. I cannot question God. Oh, why there's not a lot of people in like, if you would, you know what God does to me? And this is something that's just that I'm telling you for me, okay? My skeleton's in the closet. Amen. Into the palace we go, Chantel. So I started preaching in English only, but there weren't a lot of people listening in English, okay? So the Lord uses me to start preaching in Spanish, and I didn't like to speak in Spanish because my Spanish is not all that good. So he started to give me all these women in Spanish from all over the place, from Colombia, from Panama, from Argentina. There's like so many women that write me from like all over the place, and they say how they watch the videos and the videos are a blessing. How do they see these videos? I don't know. How they find me, I don't know, but only the Lord knows, right? So then he gives me the teachings, right? So now there's different audiences and YouTube. Some videos might do good 1 week with the Spanish videos, and with the English I'm not doing good. And then in YouTube that week, I might do good in the Spanish videos and horrible in the English. So there's always like in this platform that I'm given, that the Lord gives me, I just do my videos and I don't care who's watching. I don't care how many people are there. I don't care how many people like it, how many people, whatever. Because if nobody likes it on Facebook, if nobody is enjoying it on Facebook, somebody on YouTube will be like, wow, this really blessed me today. Thank you. So we cannot second guess it. I just continue preaching on here because the Lord said preach on here. I continue doing it this way because he says to do it this way. And now I'm moving into Instagram that I want to do. Do I want to sit here? People don't realize how long it takes to do the videos, prepare for the videos, edit the videos, and upload the videos. Like, it is, this is a full-time job. And people think, oh, I just sit there. People will think, oh, I have, like, people in my town or my city, they'll be like, oh, she has nothing to do. Or people will be like, oh, you didn't call me back, and I'm like so busy, you know, doing the things of the Lord. And then I have to tend to my husband, then I have to tend to my children, then I have to tend to the church and my spiritual life. That's what I'm telling you, everything that we are going through has a purpose. What you're going through will bring you closer to God, will bring you closer to the Word, will bring you closer to your purpose, okay? It will not, this is a clean, what I give here on YouTube are clean teachings, and you will never see me on here asking for offerings. You never see me sitting here and be like, oh, everybody, and there are so many videos and things that I do sometimes, and I even forget, you know, and because I don't do it, because I don't have a bank online, like where people could go and donate. Yeah, I don't have that. We just have the money order thing, you know, online or whatever, and that helps us out. But we trust God. We trust God with everything that we do. We trust God, and we allow God to bless us. That's why we don't have to talk about offerings every service. I don't have to, even in church, we don't have to bombard crazy people, you know, people all the time with offerings. And guess what? Other churches will look at us, criticize us, but guess what? In the towns, those people that come to our town, when they go over there, they're gonna preach, and they're gonna be like, you know what, I know these people, that they're very humble, I know these people, that they can interpret the Word, I know these people, and you know what, God is gonna elevate us the way he wants to and in his time. So we just gotta continue being what? Faithful. We got to continue being humble. We got to continue being meek, and we got to get all those skeletons what out of our closet in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Are you guys ready? Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, and please pray for me. Amen. Pray for our ministry. Pray that God will elevate us. Pray that God will bring us into the palace ASAP. Amen. Heavenly Father, I come before your presence, and I thank you, Father God, for your word. I thank you for my sisters. I thank you, Father God, for what you're doing in their life. Father God, I thank you, because nothing that the enemy has tried to do to come up against them will prosper. Father God, I declare abundance in their life right now. I declare prosperity in their life right now. I declare good health over their life. I declare godly, heavenly wisdom over their life right now. Father God, I declare that you're going to make them unstoppable. Father God, let a current come from heaven and deposit it into their spirit right now, Father God, so that they can do those mighty and amazing things that you have called them to do. Father God, you have said that the last will be first and the first will be last, Father God, and I declare that this morning, this afternoon, you are going to take them from that bottomless pit, and you are going to put them into the palace, and I declare it in the mighty name of Jesus for each and every one of my sisters. I declare it for myself, Father God, because you are not a man to lie. Men will lie all the time, but you, my Lord, are not a man that you shall lie. You are God. You are the Alpha. You are the Omega. You are the beginning and the end, Father God. And there is no one like you. And I thank you so much for depositing this word in my spirit. I thank you so much for depositing this series into my spirit, Father God. And I declare that it is going to be amazing. I declare that it is going to be so many amazing things that are going to come out of this. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. And we are just believing in your word and in your wisdom. God, have your way in our life. Amen. I love you guys. Remember, I'm Janice Batista. Please share this word on your page. Before you go, please hit the share button on your page and just share this broadcasting with somebody on your wall so that they may be blessed by this word as well. If you need any other words of encouragement, definitely subscribe to my YouTube channel. Remember, I'm in Greensboro, North Carolina, so you can definitely come check us out if you're in the area. And if you're not in the area, area and you do not have a home church, go check out our church page and a church YouTube page, and you will be able to see all of our weekly bilingual videos that are there to bless your life and help you grow on your spiritual journey. Okay, and all of that information is going to be right in the description box, so you cannot miss it. Every video is going to be right there, and I will see you guys, like I said, God willing, next week. I have to let you guys go. Today is my youngest daughter's birthday, so we're about to go out, we're about to celebrate, about to go to probably eat at Golden Corral. I love my steak, I love my mashed potatoes, I love my corn, I love everything in Golden Corral. That's like one of my favorite spots. Or we may go to Chili's, I don't know, one of the two. But we're gonna go celebrate and have a good time, and I just pray that you guys will find peace and joy in your life. Enjoy life. Do not be stressed out. Don't let family stress you out. Don't let church stress you out. Pastors, bishops, anybody. Don't let nobody stress you out. Know that God has greater things in store for you guys. I believe it. And if God said it to be so, that is amen. Thank you, sweetie Blanca. That is exactly what is going to be. And that's why I pray for my daughters and pray for my children too. Amen. And I keep proclaiming over them that I know that they are going to walk in the ways of God. I, you know, continue, you know, proclaiming that they're going to do mighty things. They're going to make hell tremble. Amen. Because I know that God is just going to use them in mighty ways. Amen. You guys too. God, thank you, sweetie Susie. You guys have an awesome weekend. Okay, guys, have a good time. And don't forget to set your alarms on Sunday and go to church. Okay, guys, don't be forgetting church on Sundays. I know that we be feeling good when we be receiving the word here, but there is nothing like going into the house of God. Do not be, thank you, Chantal. I'm going to definitely let her know. You know, there's nothing like going into the house of God and letting God deposit more godly wisdom. The more you submit yourself to God, the more you submit yourself to the service of the kingdom. Oh my God, that is where God is going to qualify you to go into the palace. Okay, because when you just sit there, you remember Joseph had to go through that process of working. Amen. He had to go through that process of laboring. Okay, so go into the house of God this week with a different heart, with a different mentality, with a different mindset. And they're going to be like, man, what happened to you this weekend? And that's probably why I was feeling all that demonic oppression, because now I don't feel it. But you see, when I was going through it, man, I felt like I was going to like black out or something. I'm like, oh my God, like this is so satanic. And I just kept feeling a big headache over my forehead. And when you go to church, be like, can I help you guys out with the cleaning? Can I help you guys out with the children's ministry? What can I do? Because the faster you get into the pit, the faster you get into work, the faster you're going to be like, right into the palace. Amen. So I love you guys. Like I said, please don't forget to share this video and help this ministry grow. Okay. I know some of you guys did it last week, and just continue helping me out and doing that each and every week. Okay, guys. So I love you. Have an awesome weekend. Bye.